I would like to start by mentioning that I'm happy to present at the second Virtual Virus Bulletin Conference. I'm Doina, and together with my colleagues June Ryan, as well as my co-presenter Cătălin, we decided to investigate correlations between various infection vectors and ransomware victims. As you probably already know, the topic of our presentation, ransomware, is a hot topic in the media, but not only. A lot of things have happened since we submitted our abstract a few months ago. Some ransomware threat actors decided to retire, while others decided to rebrand their ransomware. However, we believe that our findings are still relevant because we didn't focus on a particular ransomware threat actors, but rather on what various ransomware threat actors have in common. Usually, a ransomware infection consists of five stages. The first stage is gaining initial access to the system or network in which the threat actor is interested. After gaining this foothold, the threat actor performs various local operations, such as credential stealing, privilege escalation, or lateral movement. After this, the attacker starts to gather and exfiltrate the data that he finds in that environment. Only after performing these three steps, the attacker encrypts the data and shows the victim a message that requests the victim to pay a ransom and threatens to expose the data that he managed to exfiltrate if the ransom is not paid. For the purpose of our presentation, which is to ensure that the last two steps do not happen, we are mostly interested in how the ransomware threat actors perform the first three stages. Since we are doing this completely from outside, meaning we do not have any signal or data gathering within the systems or networks where the ransomware infections happen, we started by gathering a list of companies known to have been infected by ransomware. In order to do this, we used data leakage websites. Usually, threat actors use onion websites in order to post on them the identity of the companies they have infected, as well as the data they have managed to exfiltrate from their environments. This website presents three examples of such websites, but there are many, many more. On the left, you can see the Continuous, in the middle, the Doppelpaymer website, and on the right, the Revel's Happy Blog. Although we were not interested in the data that was leaked, we parsed these websites in order to gather the identity of the infected companies and the approximate date at which they got infected, more like when their data was leaked. In order to give you an idea of how many companies find themselves in this situation, we computed the number of companies that had data leaked on various ransomware websites since January 2020. You can see that the number of companies in this situation started modestly, but towards the middle of 2020, it gained traction and managed to remain at around 200 companies every month. Since the paper was due in June, we decided to perform our analysis for March, April, and May 2021. During this period, we managed to collect 750 companies from 27 different ransomware leakage websites. This slide shows the number of companies that have data leaked by a particular ransomware family in March, April, and May by the 10 most prolific ransomware families. After we collected these 750 companies, we decided to compute their digital footprint. By digital footprint, we mean finding out which IP addresses belong to these companies. We used the work performed by our amazing attribution team, which performs this task by looking at various datasets such as passive DNS, who is information, and so on. In order to have an idea of how big these companies are, we decided to group them by the number of IP addresses that were attributed to them. And as you can see in this slide, most of the companies have less than 1,000 IP addresses. There are a few with a lot more IP addresses, but those usually belong to telecommunications companies. Although we did our analysis on all these 750 companies, for the purpose of NetFlow analysis, we only used the 600 companies that have less than 1,000 IP addresses attributed to them. And now I will let Cătălin walk you through the information that we managed to find out about the first two stages of a ransomware infection, initial access and lateral movement, and then I'll get back to you with data exfiltration techniques and conclusions.
Hi, I'm Cătălin, and how Dana mentioned, I'll present the initial access and the lateral movement parts. For initial access, we have six categories, and those six categories are exposed services, vulnerabilities, spam, decredentials, application security, and malware infections. For exposed services, what we did was to identify which services were exposed for those 600 companies, and we found on first place FTP as being the main service used by close to 180 companies, and also we found the services related to emails, like POP3 and IMAP, also services related to databases like MySQL, Postgres, and Microsoft SQL, and some services that are more related to ransomware infections like RDP, Telnet, SMB, and VNC. For example, RDP is known to be used by some ransomware initial malware infection because they could use RDP with some leak credentials, or they could have found out from other sources some credentials that work for that particular server, or they could try to brute force the server in order to find the username or password, or they could exploit it. So it is a way to get inside a company. Next, what we did was to find abuse services. We defined an abuse service as a service that for a short period of time has a considerable more requests than what usually has. We defined that to have at least 5 times more requests than 95 percentile. And in this case, we found out that HTTPS, HTTP, and SSH were on the first three places. Here we have an interesting example of SSH brute forcing, where for a short period of time, approximately 5 hours, it looks like a brute force was tried on a SSH server for a particular company, and later, after 1.5 months, that company appeared on a ransomware leak website. We don't know for sure if this brute force was successful. Maybe the threat actors tried multiple ways to get inside that company. Maybe they were also sending spam emails or doing some exploitation. But if the company knew that they were attacked at this moment in time, maybe they could take some measures to protect themselves. Next, we have an example for RDP brute forcing. Here we notice a high number of requests to RDP service for approximately 5 days, and later we found that company in a ransomware leak website. Also, we were able to notice 1 month later after this brute force that possible infiltration took place, because data in size of 4 gigabytes was transferred over RDP protocol. So in this case, we could identify what it looks like an initial access with an RDP brute force, then an exfiltration, and at the end, after ransomware infection, that company appeared on a leaked website. And the company maybe could have protected themselves before this ransomware infection took place. Related to vulnerabilities, what we did was to look on CVEs with proof of concept initially, and we found out that a lot of CVEs were associated with our companies, even older CVEs like 2011 CVEs. But VCVs, presence of VCVs doesn't mean that they will be used as an initial infection vector. Some CVs may be related to get some additional information, to leaking some information, or to make a service unavailable. So next step was to filter out only the CVs that are related to remote code execution. And we have a smaller number of CVs and a smaller number of companies that are vulnerable to VCVs, but VCVs are more important and someone could use them to run remotely code on their servers. So they should update faster their servers in order to protect them from these critical CVEs. Related to spam, what we did was to look on SPF record. SPF stands for Sender Policy Framework. And what it does is to specify which IPs are allowed to send emails for a particular email domain. And for example, if that SPF record is missing, then someone could easily impersonate that an email from that company and send spam to other companies or even inside the company. And what we found is that close to 250 companies had have a SPF record soft fail setting. That means that the emails that don't come from that particular IPs that are specified in SPF record will be marked as spam emails, but will still make it to the destination. So there's still a low chance for someone to click on spam from both emails, but at least they make it to the spam folder. But we found also close to 150 companies that have missing this record. So this means that in that case, the companies could be more vulnerable to impersonation attacks related to spam. Also, we found malformed SPF records and SPF records with wildcards. What we also did was to search in our spam traps to see if we're receiving spam from these companies, and we found a few examples of emails that were impersonating persons from those companies and were sending spam with real malware attachments. Related to leak credentials, what we did was to look in known leak databases with credentials and to see which emails we find from those 600 companies, and we found a lot of emails for a lot of companies, like at least half of the companies were found in seven data dumps, which means that it's easy for a threat actor to find emails that belong to a company in order to know to which email addresses to send spam or which email addresses to impersonate, you know, in order to make their campaign more efficient. For application security, we looked on misconfiguration or password vulnerabilities on the company's websites, like the possibility of using cross-site scripting injects or if they have an improper HTTPS redirect. In particular, these possible security problems may not be on initial access, but they suggest that the company may have poor security hygiene, and someone could also maybe extract more information from that company or make their website users vulnerable to some possible attacks. Related to malware, we looked on our sinkholes to see from which IPs that belong to those 600 companies were receiving requests and to which malware families those requests belong. And we found Andromeda and Configure being in top in close to 20 companies, also Sality, Emotet, Letic, and so on were present there. In particular, Emotet is a malware family that is highly correlated to ransomware infections, but the other families are malware families that are not necessarily targeting a ransomware infection. For example, Configure is quite old ransomware malware family for older than 10 years. So this means that probably those companies have very old systems that probably they run Windows XP and they don't even have an antivirus product, so they are more vulnerable to new possible infections, given that they have this malware already running on their systems. What we did next was to identify which malwares that are directly correlated to ransomware infections are present on or were present on those companies' networks. And we found the Emotet, Tribot, Didrex, Ursnif, and so on. And how we did this was to look to get the list of command and control IPs that were used by these mother families, and then to know a connection using NetFlow to see which company's IP is connected to those command and control servers. And we also had to remove VIPs that look like shared hosting, because in that case we could not differentiate between a connection to a command and control server versus a connection to a legitimate website. And that's why we were left with fewer infections and fewer companies that were made connections to those command and control servers. This list could be bigger. We don't have perfect information in this case, but we can say that there were companies that made connections to known command and control servers for these families. Here we have an interesting example where I have a Tribot infection that started on May 18th, and then May 20th this company was present on a ransomware leak website. It may be strange that this period of time is so short, but it doesn't mean that initial infection took place on 18 May. It could have been 1 month earlier, and they had time to do the lateral movement, the exfiltration, and then at the end running Tribot and ransomware. So this could be an explanation for the reason which this short period of time between Tribot and the ransomware being the company being present on the ransomware leak website. Related to lateral movement, we concentrated on CobaltStrike infections. We did that similar to malware related to ransomware. We collected close to 5,000 IP addresses that were known to be CobaltStrike command and control servers, and then we made the correlation between which companies connected to both command and control servers. We also had to remove VIPs that looked like shared hosting, and at the end we ended up with only 25 companies that made requests to this type of command and control servers. And here we see that Conti ransomware companies that were infected with Conti ransomware, six of them made the connections to a known CobaltStrike command and control server. What could have been important for these companies was that if they knew that they were making connections to a CobaltStrike command and control server, maybe they could do a further investigation and stop a further infection of the ransomware down the line. Next, I'll invite Doina to continue with the exfiltration part.
As promised, I am back for the data exfiltration stage of the ransomware infection. In order to discover data exfiltration techniques, we searched in NetFlow the IP addresses belonging to companies that were infected by ransomware. In particular, we were looking for spikes in the amount of data exchanged between the IP addresses belonging to the infected companies and other IP addresses. In this way, we managed to uncover various data exfiltration use cases, and I'm going to present a few of them in the following slides. The first use case is a potential data exfiltration performed by the Revel ransomware to the MegaCloud over HTTPS. The image illustrates the number of gigabytes exchanged hourly between an IP address belonging to a company that was infected by Revel and various other IP addresses. We can observe a spike on March 21st between 3 a.m. and 3 p.m. This spike shows the communication between the infected company's IP address and three other IP addresses that are associated with MegaCloud. 1 month after this spike, on April 26th, data belonging to this company was leaked on the Revel's Happy blog. In the image, we can also observe a few 4 GB spikes. However, given their prevalence, we assume that this is just the company backing up their data. The second use case is a potential data exfiltration performed by the LV ransomware to the Rackspace Cloud over SMB. The image illustrates the number of gigabytes exchanged hourly between an IP address belonging to a company that was infected by LV and other different IP addresses over SMB. We can observe three spikes between April 8 and April 13. These spikes show the communication between the infected company's IP address and various other IP addresses that are associated with the Rackspace cloud. 6 days after the last spike, on April 19, data belonging to this company was leaked. The third use case illustrates a candidate data exfiltration performed by the DarkSide ransomware to DigitalOcean over SSH. The image illustrates the number of gigabytes that were exchanged between an IP address of a company that was infected by DarkSide and other IP addresses. We can observe a spike on May 6th, and this spike shows the communication between the infected company's IP address and an IP address that is associated with DigitalOcean. 2 days after this spike, on May 8th, information about this company being infected by the DarkSide ransomware was posted in the news. As you observed, the attackers use different ways of exfiltrating the data, and they use different communication protocols. However, what they have in common is that they usually use IP addresses belonging to various cloud providers in order to upload the stolen information on them. Also, we can observe that the data exfiltration patterns happened prior to the data being leaked. However, or while investigating this type of use cases, we also stumbled upon some use cases in which we observed data exfiltration patterns post-leak. This is such an example. In the top image, you can see the spike in the number of flows exchanged between the infected company's IP address and an IP address associated with Rackspace. And in the bottom image, you can see a similar spike, but in the number of gigabytes for the same time frame. Since these post-leak data exfiltrations happened over HTTPS, and because we know that when a server's data is encrypted, you can browse its information as an open directory, we have some assumptions about why we observed such patterns. The first assumption is that the attacker performed the data exfiltration in this way, because he knew that after encrypting the server's data, he will be able to download the encrypted data. Or maybe he did some data exfiltration prior to this, but after realizing that the company is not going to pay the ransom, he decided to download as much information as possible from the infected servers. Our second assumption is that the company itself, along with some third party perhaps, which is trying to help it recover from the attack, downloaded the encrypted data in this way in order to find a way to decrypt it. Our third assumption is that a third party, unrelated to the company or to the attacker, learned about the leak from the news or from the DataLeaks website and decided to download the data, hoping that he will be able to decrypt it at a later date. Since we observed these patterns for the Avadon ransomware, and since in the meantime Avadon decided to retire and to make the private keys public, if our third assumption is correct and the third party decided to download the encrypted data, we know that they have the private keys to decrypt it. As you have observed, the first two stages, initial access and lateral movement, usually happen in a similar way to other attacks as well, not just for ransomware. So the recommendations are usually similar, and here they are. With regards to credentials, don't reuse credentials, use strong passwords, use a password manager, use multi-factor authentication, and don't make your phone number and email address easily accessible so that the attackers can find them and use them against you. With regards to exposed services, you should minimize the exposed digital footprint and use strong authentication and put services behind VPN where applicable. With regards to vulnerabilities, you should patch them immediately, especially if they provide remote code execution or privilege escalation, and also if there is a publicly or commercially available proof of concept that the attackers can use. With regards to malware, you should use an up-to-date anti-malware product. And with regards to exfiltration, you should use an intrusion detection or prevention system or a firewall in order to monitor for and block large outgoing amounts of data. Apart from these general recommendations that work for our malware families as well, we should also like to mention that ransomware attackers seem to love Cobalt Strike. So if you notice Cobalt Strike beaconing combined with outgoing large amounts of data, then you should further investigate and try to apply some preventive measures because you might be in the middle of a ransomware attack. And this was all. Thank you for listening.